Okay, before we start, I'd like to say a little bit about my background, I mean, in terms of functionally. The many years, most of my career, I was at the Institute of English and Foreign Languages, which is now called EFLU. And I think Dr. Malati Krishnan, who came, and Dr. Prabhakar Babu has just retired from there. I retired about the same time, a little earlier, actually. Now, for many years, what we were doing there was in-service teacher work. Something called the PG Diploma in English was our flagship program. That's actually a post-MA program. So from every state or most states, one or two teachers would be deputed for the 1 year, for the 9 month diploma program. Now this was a course which was started in the late 60s, started with school level work, but after about 60s, we had it for college teachers as well, because the teaching of language became an important issue. That most of you with your MAs in English literature are oriented to teaching. You can teach poetry, drama, novel, and the rest, you know that. But teaching general English, because now it's taken for granted, but at that time, most people didn't have any background in this. So how to teach language skills, how to teach the, you know, basics of grammar, composition, and so on, was seen as a problem. So teachers would come for training, and of course they'd get some grammar, phonetics, linguistics, a basic course in literature. But we'd also orient them to methodology, materials, and my unit would teach something about testing. That's how it started. So that went on till about 2000. Then, of course, the Institute started MA programs, and now we have a B.Ed, and the diploma has come back. Now. So that has changed a great deal. Now, I'm saying this because most of my career, I was in this, what I call in-service work, working with teachers. And one of the things that I learned from this is that teachers already know a great deal. So it's very important not to lecture at them endlessly with new ideas. The important thing is, there are many things that you're doing. Might see the function of such programs is to give you some new information. But it has to reflect what you already know and maybe encourage you to think in a different way. So the amount of new information is somewhat limited. I've always maintained that the UGC orientation course, refresher course, should be about 30% maybe new information. After all, if you have a resource person, they should have something new to say. But the important thing is how this interacts with what you're already doing. Okay? And that, in the second part, second and third parts, we look at, okay, what we do with examinations, which are all involved in examinations. You're doing paper setting, you're marking, you're giving feedback to students. And also you're thinking about how to test language skills and so on. So that will come closer to your practice. And there, I think there will, I hope there'll be very much more interaction and discussion. But even now, at any point, if something I'm saying is not clear, please feel free to just stop and make a comment or ask a question or whatever. Okay, our first theme here, the notion of evaluation in human affairs. So I want you to forget examinations and get on to the notion of what I call evaluation. The first point to make there is that evaluation is something which has a very central role in a given set of characteristics, purposive, adaptive, or intelligent behavior as distinct from instinctive, habitual, ritualistic, and manipulated behavior. Okay, let's say, what is the difference between purposive behavior and habitual behavior? I put two categories over there. What is an example of habitual behavior in a social context? I mean, we have habits of drinking coffee and, you know, doing yoga. I'm talking about in a public or habitual or ritualistic behavior. What are some rituals that we normally take part in?
Pardon? Changing ourselves according to
rituals and custom.
Morning, we worship God, rituals,
huh. Okay, that is personal, but in a public, so they say customs and rituals.
When we meet, we greet the person.
Yeah, we meet to greet, or in a more public sense, if you have, like I came in, you all stood up when I came because I'm a guest. Okay, and then usually you welcome and you put garlands. Of course, after Rajiv Gandhi, garlands stopped. It's a pity. Such things, okay? Now, these are activities which we engage in over and over again. We never really ask, are they important? They don't have any instrumental value. Okay? they are, we go, we, you know, we take on weekend, we go out with the children, we go to the park, we go for a picnic, or we go and visit elders in the family. In a sense, there's a small obligation to do it. But that we say it is satisfying in itself. It is not instrumental. Now, what do you think purposive behavior is, which I'm contrasting, or goal-directed behavior? Can you think of?
Changing of behavior as per the purpose that we require.
But what are some of the purposes for which we get together and engage in activities?
Education.
Yeah.
Literally.
Education is something that is in a massive at the state level. Can you think of something smaller? So, Vincent, I'm sure you're members of teachers' committees, or teachers' unions, and so on. When you get together, you don't just get together to have chai. Okay, there's something to be discussed. Then you say, we must meet, we must have a discussion, we must maybe prepare a letter, send it to the authorities, because we want something to happen.
To take decisions.
Yeah, so that means we are doing something in order to achieve something else. Okay, now that is what purposive behavior is. That is, or another way to call it, goal-directed behavior. Now, if you have goal-directed behavior, then it's very important that we reach our goals. And any serious goal-directed activity can only be reached in steps. So we need to check on the way whether we are on the right track, whether we're going far enough, we're going in the right direction, whether we should use something different, and so on. In the old days, when I'm sure all of you are teachers of English literature, must have stories of on the ships, which were some of the important officials, because always a captain, sometimes he was a pirate, but there were the people who sort of pull the sails up and down and the rest of it. But there are also certain other people who are very important. You remember what, in addition to the captain and the others, the old days of sailing ships, which was a very important technical person on the ship?
No, compass, they used to hold, and they used to
that's right. Okay, the man with the compass, and is it just enough to look at the compass? What else?
Show the correct direction.
Right. Anything else you remember from those stories about?
Captain.
Yeah, captain is there, and the others. He said the person who looks at the compass. Now, after the compass, what else did he do? You have to look at the map. Okay, you remember the navigator. See, without a navigator and a map, no ship would have gone anywhere, because you only see can find the pole star in the direction. That's no use. The ship could be going the wrong direction. Okay, so that had to be done regularly. And what was the purpose? To check progress. See, old days, depending on the wind, sometimes you went in this direction. Then you had to know. Okay, I've gone this way. Now I must come back this way. Okay, so this navigation, this monitoring of process going along, is very important for purpose of behavior, because you don't automatically reach. Okay. Now, that is one aspect of evaluation, that I'm in a very general sense. Now, coming closer to home, all of us unfortunately have to engage with the medical profession. Nowadays we are scared, because you go to see the doctor, old days you give a list of 5 tablets, which will cost us 20 rupees. Now he says, get the CT scan done, or get this. Anyway, that's a different matter. Now, if let's say one has some illness, now does the doctor just meet us once, and let's say you're in a hospital, what is the function of the doctor doing rounds in the morning?
He wants to see the progress.
Is that a ritual, or does it serve any purpose? Is it? You agree? What is the purpose?
To monitor the progress.
Yeah. To monitor, and if necessary, make some changes. See, if the doctor just looks and signs, then it's a custom, it's a ritual. But he says, okay, last night there was temperature, okay, last night there was no temperature, but the patient didn't eat anything, then he says, okay, maybe we can stop this medicine. So you see, a decision is taken. Just as the navigator on the ship tells the captain, we have got to this, we're going in this direction, so now we need to go in another direction if we want to reach the Gulf of Aden or whatever else it is. Okay. So I'm suggesting that this activity of evaluation, monitoring progress is unavoidable. It's a necessary feature of what I've called purposive, adaptive, intelligent behavior, which I've contrasted with, now, instinctive behavior. What is instinctive behavior? We usually say what instincts are associated more with?
Natural behavior.
Yeah, more with animals. Usually we, okay, when you say somebody is, you know, responding on his base of instincts, you're saying he's doing it without thinking. But usually we say all animal behavior is instinctive. No animal has to be taught. The bee doesn't have to be taught how to make the beehive. The bird doesn't have to be taught how to make the nest. It is what you call genetic hereditary. Now that behavior is inflexible. The bird can only make nests. The bird can't build a house out of bricks. Okay, the rabbit will make a burrow, the fox will make a burrow, and this sort of thing. Okay, so that is instinctive behavior, which is, it does serve a purpose, but that is a fixed purpose. It is not adaptive. Okay, so that's a contrast. Instinctive behavior as opposed to, now as we grow up, as small children, obviously we deal largely with instincts. We cry and we express anger, then we gradually socialized into patterns of behavior, and after that the child has certain desires and knows how to get it. So if mommy says no, the child knows how to go and sit in daddy's lap and slowly get. Okay. No, that is very intelligent, adaptive, purposive behavior. Right? Now that can't be predicted, it's not fixed. Okay. So this is very important, this notion of adaptive behavior which is flexible, which as you find that something is not working, you try something else. Okay. Now, I want to suggest that this is really the base of evaluation. Now, within that we'll see that examinations also perform a similar function. So you rightly said that education is an organized purpose of behavior. But sometimes we have to ask ourselves, is it really? It's an annual festival, you know, like we have spring, summer, autumn, winter, you know, we have, Dasara, Diwali, Basant, and of course in between there's Christmas and Ramzan and the rest of it goes. So we have admissions, then we have students coming, then the portions have to be covered, then we have union elections, then we have some midterm exams which are sometimes postponed because students' attendance is not there, or the occasional strike, and then the university exam is announced. Then I guess many of you have to go for valuation and the rest of it, and the results are declared. And next year the calendar starts again, admissions. Okay. Just go on and on and on. So if you look at it, in some ways our whole education system has become a bit of a ritual. I'm not saying it doesn't serve a purpose, but there's not much scope for us to change because of the system. Now, please don't misunderstand me. I'm not saying that you as teachers are unthinking, instinctive people. The system has become so stabilized that quite often it's possible to just go on and on. But the system is like that. There's a story of somebody who was being interviewed for a job, or a higher position, or a promotion or something, and he said, I have 10 years teaching experience. So the chairperson is supposed to ask this person, are you sure you had 10 years teaching experience, or 1 year's teaching experience repeated 10 times? No, that's a relevant question to ask for many of us. I mean, especially those of you who work in affiliated colleges. I've had the privilege of being in centers which are autonomous, where we could change the syllabus, set our own question papers, but you have to deal with a set syllabus and somebody else's question paper, and you're caught in that loop. So what you do this year, next year can't be very different. The system does not require you to be different. You as individuals, because you have your own interests and you're inspiring and you respond to your learners, your pattern of teaching will be different. But at the core, your work in a sense is repetitive. And it requires a great deal of internal energy on your part to survive in our system because of this. Okay. So what I want to say is that evaluation is something that is, is an essential aspect of our humanness. That when you say reflective, being reflective, it's not simply a question of meditating. Reflecting on what we are doing and asking, have we done the right thing? Have we done the best thing? Can we do better? And so on, that whole process of. Okay, any quick comments, observations on that? Something that I said that you disagree with, which I'm always welcome. Okay, it's probably not very controversial, but okay, now when you talk about evaluation, there are one or two points that I want to make here, that we can have a personal subjective perspective on evaluation, and that has to be contrasted with evaluation in what I call a public or social space. Now, can somebody give me examples of things that you evaluate in a personal sense?
Usually the teachers, as soon as they are able
to... No, not students. As citizens, as parents, as voters, as shoppers, what are some of the things that you evaluate? Why are supermarkets so attractive? Why do they succeed in selling things so much?
Quality.
Not just quality, even the Lala can give you quality, or you know, in Kirana shop you can get quality. Quality is there, more attractive packaging.
The way they approach.
But
the way they approach to the customer.
Yeah, well, it's made accessible.
Many goods are available.
You can pick it up, look at it, put this down. You can spend half an hour without buying anything, they don't mind. Because they know after half an hour you will buy the most expensive thing.
Ambience.
No, so what do you, when you pick up something, put it on, pick up something else, what are you doing?
Observing.
Not just observing.
Comparing.
You are evaluating, isn't it?
Evaluating.
Are you going to a cloth shop and some person brings this color of, you know, sari or bed sheets or whatever else it is, and you say no, something else, something. So in the informally we are evaluating. Now, and then if you, we go to a restaurant and get a menu, then we look at this, we look at that, and you know, so we're saying, okay, I don't want that today, I want something else. So see, these are all small occasions for evaluation. Evaluation is a very small e. I'm not making a big thing of it, but it's important to remember this is a cognitive process. We are comparing something with what might be what we consider as good and so on. Okay. Now, so in terms of the clothes you want to wear, where you want to, what sort of cloth you want to buy, the type of cycle, or sorry, I'm old-fashioned, the type of car you want to buy. Okay. In theory, we can use our own evaluation, but of course we're being pumped by, I put off my cell phone because every 30 minutes there's something offering me to join the scheme and win $5 of gold. Or okay. So we have to be resistant against this pressure of consumerism. But this is a personal choice, whether you want to have a, you know, wear silk saris or printed saris, or you want to have this style of shirt or t-shirts or whatever else it is. Now, which is a very important personal privilege that we have, and I think we should resist people who try to tell us, either for political reasons or religious reasons, or saying that you should think this way, you should do this and the rest of it. But that has to be contrasted with evaluation that we perform in a public space where we are in roles assigned to us. Now, what are some roles that we have? Okay, teachers is obvious, but even teachers, sometimes you have a special role. What are some of the special duties that are sometimes given to you in addition to teaching your subject, teaching English, that's one. But what are some other roles that you have? When I say special, anyone?
Election duty.
Election duty, yes. He's a politician. He's just no student of mine.
Models, sir. We have to behave as models, sir. So that
That's a general thing, but a specific, okay, like being election officer for the college election, that's one. What else? Can you think of something else?
Extracurricular.
Yeah, extracurricular. Okay, you have to organize a cultural, or help students organize a cultural show, etc., etc.
Community service.
Organize community service. Anything else?
To lead NCC, NSS-like organization.
Yeah, NCN, that is.
Some lecturers are asked to address.
Yeah, you have to organize, get people to come from outside and. Okay, in the refresher course, what is it, this academic staff college, they're always running after bringing people, that's how they survive. But in college, we can say, okay, here some person has come, let's invite that person to come and so on. Now, pardon? Yes. Now, see, that is more general. Okay, the word role and model, I think you're quite right. As teachers, we have certain, but that is something expected of all of us at all times. I'm talking about certain specific roles. So, sometimes... Yeah, those are other, but those are also public roles, but they are a bit more in the personal sphere. Okay, so let's take somebody who's an election officer. somebody who is responsible for organizing a cultural program or advising students. I think we should be advising students, not organizing ourselves. Or serving as a judge. Let's say there's been a drama competition. There's been a poetry recital competition. Now there, many of us, I'm sure all of you have served on as panels of judges for these things. We have to evaluate. Now there's a distinction between the color of shirt I like and the play that I like. What is it? There have to be certain objective criteria, because we have to be fair to the participating teams. You have to agree on criteria, or that has to be public. And you can't say, well, I don't like your play, therefore I'm going to cut your marks down. Of course, many people do that. I'm sure you have run into this problem. But that is a violation of the contract of the role. When the principal appoints you to be election officer, you have to be fair. So whether these are people who have harassed you in class or you think they are rowdies, if they are entitled to stand for election, you have to make sure that that is fulfilled, whether you like the person or not. Now you can say, I don't like this student, I won't let him marry my daughter, that's perfectly all right. But to say, I won't let you stand for election if he's eligible, you're not allowed to do that. Okay? So I'm making a contrast again between personal spaces for evaluation, which we are doing all the time, and then evaluation in our public roles, where we have to follow certain conventions and apply those conventions. And we should be able to defend publicly. You can't say in a public role, because I said so. We've always done that, which is partly why I think we have so much of problems in our country. But there are many, many places where the objective should be clear. The criteria should be clear. That's what you call transparency. Okay? That evaluation and transparency, if you want to look at it in ideal terms, you can't have good evaluation without transparency, because evaluation is not something that is hidden. The more we make it hidden, the more scope there is for subjectivity is the least of our problems, for manipulation, for nepotism, for all the things. So when you come to evaluation education, we can see we're very vulnerable because of a lack of clarity and transparency. Okay, one or two other passing comments. I said evaluation is related to measurement, and I'll talk a little bit about measurement in section B. Now, most of the time when you talk about measurement and evaluation, especially in the context of education and elsewhere, we have a lot of people now who are doing project evaluations and consultants, whether it's about dams or about a better rapid transport system or putting better traffic lights or reducing pollution. So we have a lot of this project evaluation. I'm sure you're aware of that, plus what we do in examinations. In recent years, the technology of evaluation has been, the old days we used to call them the slide rule people, people who took measurements and that sort of thing. That's become easier now because everybody has a laptop. And we're threatening to give every child a laptop also. Then after that, we can dismiss all our teachers. Now, it's important to remember that evaluation is related to objectives and criteria. So while the technology is important, we need to be very clear that the why of evaluation is important. That is where we come back into our human democratic social space. Technology is important, but technology in itself does not guarantee good evaluation. And that's something in the context of tests and exams, I'll reinforce that point. That the how of technology is so impressive now. So in fact, all our classrooms and so on, it's not only in refresher, but not only here, even many classrooms I noticed will have this apparatus. So the teacher comes, opens up the laptop and connects it, and students tend to think, okay, it's all come on the screen, must be good. But you have to ask, is it really good? See, if you have good ideas, writing a few things, scribbling, and you'll see how bad my scribbling is, it should be impressive in that form. It's more attractive when it comes like this. But we need to train our students to be critical in terms of looking at the substance and not being one of the dangers of, I've resisted you, I sometimes have to use it, all this PowerPoint and the rest of it, is that something absolutely idiotic is coming, but then it and something. So students also feel it must be something important and serious. Okay. You have to guard against that.